Hello, everyone. We are sitting here with Dan Mirvish, and he is the director and co-screenwriter of Between Us. It's a wonderful film, so please go see it. So, Dan, thank you so much for being here. Tell us a little bit about the development of the script and how it came about.
Sure. It's based on an off-Broadway play by Joe Hortua, and I found I read stacks of plays. I was looking to do a play adaptation, and I turned down the play that turned into Ides of March by that George Clooney guy. He's going places, you know. He'll do fine. But I really like Between Us because it was about relationships and marriages and couples with young children and dealing with money issues and artistic integrity, and it could be done on a lower budget because it was four people in two rooms, or so I thought. So in the end, it winds up being quite a bit more than that as a film adaptation. But but we knew that we could get a great cast with it because the parts are really good.
Well, you really do. I mean, you have Julia Stiles, you have Melissa George.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And you have...
Taye Diggs.
Yes,
and David Harbour, who was in the original play.
Yeah.
So, an amazing cast. I mean, Melissa and Julia are both Golden Globe nominees. Everyone knows Taye.
Well, talk to me a little bit about some of those conversations that you had with each one of them. You know, every actor, of course, comes to the table with their own style, their own way of portraying. And, of course, coming from the writing and directing perspective, you have your own. So talk about some of, you know, those dialogues that you all had and how the character bloomed together as partnership.
Yeah, it was interesting because each one of those actors really did have their own style of working and style of acting. And, you know, I think of the four that we wound up with in the cast, Taye was the one who came on first. And I think the material really spoke to him because he's married and has a young child and had just been doing 5 years of private practice. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and the movie is really about these two male characters are photographers who were friends in graduate school, and one kind of sold out and became a big advertising photographer in the Midwest and very successful, and the other is still trying to be an art photographer in New York, and that's actually Taye's character. But I think if anything, he related to the issues of, you know, do you sell out and make money, mm-hmm. You know, as an actor in TV, you know,
right.
or do you, you know, make less money and have your artistic integrity. So I think, and I think it spoke to him on a very personal level that way. And I think that he related to that. You know, in Julia's case, she was supposed to have done a Neil LaBue play on Broadway. And at the last second, their financing fell through. They'd been rehearsing for a month or something. And she was all of a sudden available for 6 months. And her agent called me up and said, Dan, are you interested in Julia? I said, yeah.
Absolutely.
We never thought she'd be available.
Wow.
And sure enough, she read the script. And 24 hours later, she called me up. And she was in. So the trick is to find actresses at their most vulnerable emotional moment and to just swoop in and give them good material. But I think, you know, after having done the Bourne movies and doing Dexter, you know, I think she was really looking forward to doing a real, you know, meaty, dramatic role. Melissa George, you know, people know her from Alias and 30 mm-hmm. Days of Night. You know, she had done kind of films that were more genre films like Turistas and things like that. And she had done interesting work in TV. But again, this was a strong dramatic part. For her and David, having been in the original play, you know, the part was his, you know, I mean, it was developed around him, you know, in many regards. So so they all kind of brought something different to the table and different styles. But the key was we spent 2 weeks rehearsing in my kitchen. Yeah.
In your kitchen?
Yeah. Well, we couldn't use the garage because that's where pre-production was.
That's great.
Yeah.
I love it. That's great.
And they really all committed to that, which a lot of actors on big budget movies, little budget movies, you know, it's hard to get 2 weeks rehearsal. But if you tell each actor, you know, well, you know, the other three, they're going to be rehearsing. If you don't want to, that's fine. And they're like, oh, no, I'm there, you know. And regardless of what their agents or managers tell you about, you know, availability, they'll show up, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's great for them, and it's great, you know, as a director to just let them. And our Joe, the playwright, was there with us during the rehearsal process.
Oh, wow.
So people had questions about the characters, and you know, and a lot of it is, you know, and with four great actors, it's, you don't necessarily need rehearsal to get good performances. What it helps with is especially because the characters are supposed to be four really good friends, you know, two couples, mm-hmm. and who are old friends, is it just built that chemistry among them. and the familiarity with each other, but also when they have questions about, oh, what does this word mean, or what, you know, or let's talk about the motivation of this particular moment. You can spend an hour talking about it because you're sitting around eating melon balls in my kitchen, you know, and you don't have 50 crew people waiting there, you know, like, oh no, this is going to take a long time and you were burning time here. So it gives you that luxury to kind of work through all those issues. So then when you're on set, you're like, oh no, we talked about this in rehearsal. You know, now we know what this means.
And you have an idea of the blocking and how
that's all So it was, so that was really helpful. And then for Joe and I, we could make adjustments to the script and, you know, and he was great. I mean, a lot of playwrights would be very precious about their work, but he was very open to making small changes and you know, as it suited the actors. So
yeah, what a collaboration.
Yeah,
it's
great. And then we shot for 3 weeks in LA, and then 3 weeks later I went out to Nebraska and shot for a day and a half of exteriors there, and then went to New York for a day and a half, and we shot a number of scenes with Julia in New York, exterior stuff. So and prior to that, like 3 weeks before rehearsal even, we went with David up to a 9,000 foot mountain outside of LA to shoot one shot in the snow, because that was the only place we could find snow.
Wow.
It's set in Nebraska, but we knew at the top of the mountain it was flat. And if you frame out, there was a tree on the left and a tree on the right.
9,000 foot mountain in Nebraska.
Yeah,
I haven't
passed
that one yet.
It was in LA, but it looks like Nebraska because it's on top, it's flat.
Nice.
But just getting up there, it was, you know, we had 9 people with 400 pounds of equipment, took an hour to hike through the snow just to get to get this one
Holy
shot.
Moly.
And this was our first day, you know, I mean, that was...
Of course.
Yeah. So, but we got that shot and it made it in the movie, you know, and it's...
Nice.
And with a wheelchair too, that was the other, you know, so we had to push his wheelchair through the snow.
That's a problem.
It was, yeah. But we survived that and we thought, okay, well, what could go wrong next, you know?
Yeah. Famous last words, right?
Yeah, yeah. And we, and you know, and of course things do go wrong on a low budget movie. I mean, we had...
All the time.
You
There's
know, the first day balls. My producer came out and said, damn, we got a problem. I said, what is it? He said, one of our, one of the production assistants, one of the PAs just crashed, you know, our grip truck into another car. I said, well, was anyone hurt? He said, no one was hurt.
No.
I said, well, that's all right. You know, that happens on every one of my films that someone crashes the truck, and that's, you know, that's why you have insurance. Then the next day, same producer comes up. He says, damn, we got another problem. I said, what could it possibly be? He says, well, one of our other PAs just crashed our second truck into another car. And I said, well, that's amazing news. He said, no, it's horrible news. We had another accident. I said, no, you don't understand. I've never had a movie with more than one truck. You know, so for me, this was great. Yeah, I was like, wow, I'm making a real movie here. We're crashing trucks left and right, you know.
That's awesome. The only way to go.
Yeah.
Trucks.
Yeah,
exactly.
So I, you know, I'm sort of a glass half full kind of guy when it comes to things like that. And, you know, we didn't get our financing until 3 days before the end of shooting. And so everyone was just working for free up until that point.
Holy cow, that's awesome.
It's not awesome. I mean, it's awesome that we got it. I don't really strongly recommend making movies like that.
No.
But you do it, whatever. But everyone is so committed to it. I mean,
people
on the crew were investing in the film, which, you know, when they're giving me money, you know, that's the...
Yeah,
and the actors all worked for next to nothing and kind of flew themselves out to L.A. and, you know, put themselves up sometimes. And, you know, everyone just really committed to it. And,
that's great.
Yeah, and it turned out halfway decent.
Well, we're excited about it. We're excited to have it here at Dallas. And one last thing before we go.
Sure.
You're the co-director of Slam Dance.
Yeah, co-founder of Slam Dance Film Festival.
Tell us a little bit about your experience here in Dallas. What do you think?
Dallas is a wonderful festival, and I know some of the organizers because I see them in Park City every year, and I know James Faust picked several films from Slam Dance this year, the Dirties, and He's More Famous Than Me, and Terms and Conditions. Several films are Slam Dance films, which is great because that was, you know, when we started Slam Dance, which is kind of an alternative to Sundance, it's a snowball's throw across the street, and we started it in 95, and that was at a time when where there's really the Hollywoodization of independent film. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Miramax that's just sold to Disney and Fineline became part of Fox, and Sundance was becoming more Hollywood. And if you didn't get into Sundance, you not only would you not get distribution, I mean, I had distributors tell me point blank with my first film, oh, we like your film, we won't pick it up if it doesn't get into Sundance. But you wouldn't get into other regional festivals around the country or international festivals because they were all using the Sundance catalog as kind of shorthand for, American independent films, we'll just take all these films, you know. And part of why we started Slam Dance was to kind of break that mold and break that paradigm of you know, you had to premiere at Sundance or else. And I think this festival, Dallas, is a really great example where they didn't just take the Sundance guy. They took some films, obviously, from Sundance, but they took Slam Dance films. There's films premiering here. There's films that probably played at South By, you know. And I think that kind of the landscape of festivals has gotten a lot more democratized. You don't have to show your film in January and premiere it there. You can premiere it, you know. I mean, in our case, we premiered the film in Germany at a small festival in Oldenburg. And our North American premiere was at the Hamptons and Woodstock. And I wrote a poem this year, for Slam Dance every year. On opening night, I recite it, and it's called Putting the Festive Back into Festivals. And it really is about, you know, you should just have fun at these film festivals, because this is where your audience is. I mean, I know so many filmmakers who, they finish their film, and they're trying so hard to get into these so-called A-list festivals that they may wait 6 months or a year or never get into any of them. And meanwhile, they've wasted a year of their life where, you know, I mean, a film is like a tree in the forest. If nobody sees it, it doesn't exist. It's just light and shadow. You know, so I finished my film on a Thursday. By Friday, I was premiering it in Germany. You know, I mean, it was like, finish that thing, let's show it to people, and let's have fun with it, and do the screenings and the Q&A. And it's paid off. We just got a distribution deal last week.
There you go.
And Monterey Media is going to be releasing it starting in June,
awesome.
Theatrically. So.
And give us a website where we can find out more about it?
BetweenUsMovie.com, or you can like it on Facebook at Between Us Movie or something, and Twitter, Between Us Movie there, and friend me on Facebook, or, you know.
There you go. Well, thank you, Dan, for being with us today, and everybody go see Between Us. Thanks for watching.
Thanks very much.